I'm Aneesha and I'm a dancer. And I'm used to coming on stage and not communicating with words. So today I'm going to be using a lot of my body to be performing this dance talk. So you're going to actually get a little dance talk today because I cannot stand still. Okay, so before I start, I want to give credit to all my dance teachers because whatever I'm saying today has been taught to me by somebody else. And over the years, I've had many, many, many dance teachers. And today, I think I'm kind of feeling like, okay, I might be able to justify by sharing some of his knowledge as well. So today, I'm really happy to be here. Okay, now, I just want to ask all the audience, whether you're dancers or non-dancers, or nothing like that actually exists. But if I ask you, any of you, to come up here and just, I'll put on some music and just do a solo performance, how many of you would be ready to do that? Awesome. Okay, I love the small little hands going up. Ooh, maybe not, maybe not, maybe not. Okay, so that's like 1% in the audience. Okay, now, I'm not judging you if you had put your hand up, didn't put your hand up, doesn't really matter. But just think about why you didn't volunteer to come up. What was stopping you? Okay, the normal things that go through your mind. Okay, because I want to connect like how the mind and dance really, really go together hand in hand. And all of you didn't put your hands up. There must have been some reason, like, I don't know, I'm too old, I can't dance, I'm not fit. Okay, so those are the typical things that you think about when making a fool of yourself and things like that. But what I believe is that every single person has their own rhythm. All right? It's there with us from the moment we're born till the moment we die. This is a riddle. Anybody knows what it is? It's inside you. I'm giving you a clue. Your heartbeat. Yes, okay. So that is dum-dum, dum-dum, dum-dum. That's a rhythm. Okay, that is nature's rhythm and it exists in each and every one of us. So that is why I believe that every single person can dance. Now you'll be thinking, no, I know there's some people but two left feet and all that, but they are dancing to their own rhythm. They have their own rhythm. Okay, so as long as you are moving, okay, and you are not thinking, that is dance. And that's what I want to talk about today. But I believe dance is way, way much more than that. Like, music and dance are the highest forms of spirituality. I really believe that. Because if you think about it, in most religions, we have music and dance. If you go to Sufi, you have you're singing in church, you have your bhajans. It's there because it does create some sort of energy. Okay, that really, really does flow. And then what happens to us? Our ego comes in and stops us right there. So how, what will I look like, right? So I'm talking about that dance where you go to another level. So in my early years when I started out, when I was still a student and I won some sort of student prize Shiamak had given us and it was a lovely frame, beautiful dancers, and turned it over and he had written something at the back. So he didn't know me very well then, but he had written, if you work hard and have a smaller head, you'll go far in life. Okay, now that's just a simple one line. And that time I was like, oh, I have a big head. That's what I thought. Like, I was like, oh, okay. Still today, I don't even know big head or no. Shiamak is always correcting us. Okay, but it is about that ego. When you want to be successful in anything, I believe, but more so when it's an art form, that you've got to suppress that and know that you can never be perfect because you're always growing. Dance is always evolving. Music is always evolving. You can never reach the top. There is no top. It's always like limitless to the sky. So that is what I love about it because it's always growing and I know that I can never be perfect. It's very frustrating, but you know that you can't be perfect. You have to just learn how to live with it. Okay, so that is like that ego that stopped maybe all of you from putting your hands up and saying, yeah, I'll come and just do some dance. Don't care. Okay, so just remember and think about if our minds could just change a bit and we saw dance or we just saw ourselves differently, how different would our lives be and all our fears would be evaporated and we'd just be much more freer individuals than we are. Okay, so forget that. I'm not making you feel bad now. You're all beautiful. So you'll all dance. After I give you a few beers, maybe you'll everyone be like, ah, yeah. Then I'll dance. That's what happened to me all my life. My friends, I'm like, come on, let's go to dance floor. Yeah, I'm coming. I'll just have a few drinks and I'll come. So that's, you need that little thing to loosen you up, I guess, which is fine. No judgment. Okay, so anyways, talking about the body, now I'm not going to go into the benefits of dance and it's so exercise and fit and all that, because I think everyone knows that already. But I do want to talk about the emotions within the body. All right, now in our lives, there's something called body language, and our bodies react to certain emotions. All right, the physical manifestations, like if you're sad, you cry, right? The tears come out. That's physical. It just happens. It's something that happens. All right, the English language has all the terms, jump for joy and tremble with fear, and your body does, right? It moves according to emotions, okay? So now, deeper rooted emotions and probably unresolved problems or anything that is really affecting you and you don't know how to deal with it, it goes in our bodies unconsciously. You're not aware of it. You probably think, I've dealt with it, okay, it's just there, leave it, I don't want to think about it. But it has to go somewhere. It doesn't go out into the universe because you haven't really maybe resolved it. So it goes into the body somewhere. It settles down. In severe cases, it becomes a bigger ailment, diseases. And there's a very simple solution to that. It's just to dance, to move. Because what your voice and your words can't convey, your body can. That's why we use it in dance therapy nowadays. We use the body to speak what we can't probably handle to actually say out loud. So even if you think it's something as frivolous as putting on maybe a Bollywood song, people don't ever take that as, you know, serious, you know, dance. But if you are just dancing, sometimes maybe all of you have done that at some point, alone in your room and put the music on and just dance and sang and pretended you're a pop star, that is actually healing for you without you knowing it. Unconsciously, again, you are releasing some part of some energy out of your body which needed to get out. So that is something that is going away from your body, and it unconsciously is healing you. Okay, so that is something that I don't think everyone is aware of, not even me, but unconsciously everything goes in, unconsciously everything also can come out when we move. Okay, so I believe dance can be the biggest healer if we all just danced without the beers. Okay, now there's another thing, the interesting bit called muscle memory in the body. All right, I don't know if you've heard that term before, we use it a lot in dance. And it's just when we remember the routines and the choreography in our bodies and not in our heads anymore. So you learn a bit of choreography and you're doing it and you do it again and you do it again. Like you remember something, you've got to repeat. But after a point, you can just do it, okay, whatever you're doing, the dance, and you can do something. It's like multitasking. You don't have to constantly think what's the next step or what is. I'll give you a good example. I recently met Shahid Kapoor at one of our award functions. We were working together and he used to dance with me like really long time ago, like 15 or 18 years ago. And we got to talking and we've met many times, you know, in the past. But this particular time we suddenly remembered this routine or something. And we just said 5, 6, 7, 8. And we both and a couple of other people as well, we just did that entire routine. And this is something from literally, I think, 18 years ago. And we've never done it since. But at that point, 18 years ago, we must have rehearsed it so much that we just didn't forget it. And I think that is amazing that the human body can remember that, because it was definitely not our minds remembering it. It was definitely not. So that's what we call muscle memory. And that is the basically how the body remembers. Okay, because sometimes people don't imagine a Govinda to be a dancer. But that is exactly what dance is. Okay, so dance comes from the heart, it comes from the soul. They sound like cliches, but whether it's Bharatanatyam, ballet, hip hop, anything, the more technique you have, the great, I mean, that's good. But if you don't have the soul, you're not ever going to be portraying and giving to the audience, and then you don't get that back from the audience. So I'll give you another example. This is again my ballet teacher. She, I was giving this ballet exam, distinction, and I was like, Yeah, I know how hard I had to work to get that distinction. So I'd been dancing already for like 10 or 15 years professionally, and then I decided to give this ballet exam. So it's just an exam where you do a series of exercises, dances, and someone from the RAD, from the Royal Association of Dance, comes from London and examines you, and you dance one by one, and you get points, and you get a certificate, and all that. So while I am preparing for this exam, my teacher kept telling me, Aneesha, where's the dancer gone? Aneesha, where, what? You are looking down, you don't look confident, what is happening to you? And I didn't understand. I'm saying, what? I'm doing everything you're telling me to, and I'm doing it. And this is after 15 years, so I'm already a professional dancer. It's not like I'm starting out new, and I couldn't understand what was I doing that she was not getting, or what was I not doing, really. Then she said, you're not dancing. And then I realized, I'm like, oh. Because I was only thinking, because it was an exam. And I had never been examined before as a dancer. You just perform, you know, no one really comes up to you and goes out, you're nitty gritty and your left toe was not correct and your little finger was wrong. And it was that intricate, the whole examination was that, you know, difficult. And I was only thinking and I was doing everything correctly, but there was nothing coming out. There was no performance. And that's when I realized, I was like, oh, I'm thinking. And to not think is it's really, really, really difficult. Yeah, so if that soul isn't there, you got to find it somehow. So like I said, even if it's you're dancing in that one little Bollywood song in your room, that is so much bigger than doing this whole ballet exam and doing technically correct steps and moving. So really, really, dance is two different things. Even if you're a performer, you still have got to give. Even if you're just dancing socially, you still have got to give. You must have all had experiences just watching someone dance at a wedding or in a party. Some auntie, uncle, just suddenly they just come and they just like go for it. Or you have that one friend who just says, "Arey, just chal," and they just go. And that is something, and everybody's watching them and going, yeah, and you just wanna, you just feel the joy because there's no inhibitions. And that never happens for a long time, but it does happen. And that is what pure joy and pure dance really is. And happens on both levels, even as a performer. It's very difficult to get to that state. So again, another ballet example, there's this performance, there was this performance by Margaret Fontaine, who was a very famous ballerina. And she does, finished. The entire audience was silent when she finished. Like for 10 seconds, there was just nothing. And then the applause started. So what had happened was she had just taken them into another zone. She had transcended because of her joy or her performance, whatever it was, had gone into the audience, mesmerized them, and that's why no one clapped. It was a brilliant performance and it just stunned them into just, where are we? So even if it is somebody, I mean, you can be a performer as well and give that, very difficult to do. Okay, or you can be the other way around. You can just be socially dancing and just, you know, bringing in everyone towards you. Come, let's do one thing. Okay, I'm going to do one muscle memory exercise with you all. Are you ready? You all don't have to stand up, okay? I'm going to teach you one little arm movement, okay? And then you have to reverse it. So ready? Just go in, down, up, and push out. Don't hit anybody. Okay, now reverse it. Very good. Brilliant. No, yeah, okay. Not bad. Okay? That was muscle memory, okay? These are Luigi, he's a choreographer. These are like a little linear arms that he has. And you can do them in, eventually it's like maths, okay? And I hated maths in school. And then in ballet and contemporary, we do the same thing. We'll do a whole routine, everything on the left side, everything to the left, everything left leg, left arm, left side. And then your teacher will turn around and say, and now to the right. And then you have to just, like, okay, then you're literally figuring it out. So, I mean, I'm talking two different things today. I'm saying you've got to use your mind, you've got to lose your mind also when you dance. Okay, so it's completely different when you're learning choreography. Even, I don't know how many of you must have just been at Sangeets and, you know, done that little performance or your friends or whenever in school and college and, you know, that whole thing of learning choreography and then you've got to forget, you've got to lose it and just perform. So that's the sole part of the dance which I really, really love. I had a lot of opportunities to be a part of the Bollywood film industry, I mean, years ago, and people couldn't understand that, what? Well, you're not doing that? You want to be a dancer? And I was like, yeah, and I didn't understand at that point. I'm not showing off or anything, but really, I had found my my spirituality or my dance. And I knew that that's, and I understood that at a really young age, especially because I was also a teacher. So we teach everybody. I teach a four-year-old and we teach senior citizens. Those are the best groups, by the way. Then in between, we are all inhibited. Okay, but love, the love for teaching also, because I could see what dance does to people, even on a small little level of just performing at a school function or a little bit of performing at home or whatever. And I just really loved that soul part of the dance. So obviously you have everything. You've got the mind, you have the body, you have the soul. You've got to have all three, and then you become a complete dancer. So I was talking about Govinda. I mean, I love him. And you, I don't look like a person who really like Govinda as a dancer, but he really dances from the heart. When you see him, and just, you have to just look at his face. You don't want to look at his legwork and all that. And beautiful. Not putting any of the others down, but just to give an example, like if you asked a dancer who's the best dancer, you wouldn't expect a Govinda answer. You know, so because that's that soul that comes out of someone. Even in fact, recently, there's one last example. I was at a wedding and with all my dancer friends, and there was no alcohol served at that wedding. But if you looked at the dance floor, it looked like everyone has had 100 drinks, because we are dancers and we're used to it and whatever. Everyone, because we were dancing, everyone else at the wedding also came. And one guy just, I was standing out and he came and he flopped down. He's saying, "Are thak gaye." I said, "Yeah." He's saying, "But you know what? Every day we are doing correct things, and today I just wanted to do all wrong." So for him, he thought it's all wrong, but they were rolling on the floor and doing, you know, just being stupid, and they really didn't care. But that, to get to that level also takes a while, where you aren't worried about what people think of you. And I always like to think of life as a dance performance. So the curtain goes up, and there you are. Then you start dancing, you start living your life. At some point, there might be people with you, lots of people. You might be pushed to the front row, you might be pushed to the back. At some point, you might just be alone. Nobody's around you, no one on stage with you. But you still have to continue dancing because the show must go on. And so you do your solo. You might stumble and fall. You can't stay there. The show must go on. You've got to get up. You've got to keep on moving. And the audience is always there, judging you. They might applaud, they might boo, but they're always there. And you just have to keep going until the curtain comes down. And then you know you've just done your best, because what else can you do? And all that's left is to take a bow. And that's it. Thank you.